A very good afternoon, judges. I, along with my teammates, would like to present our report of credit research of Vedanta. So this is just the holding structure of the company, how Vedanta Resources PLC, that is the UK company, holds 50% in Vedanta Limited. These are the six major divisions in which Vedanta is involved in. In this slide, I would like to focus on how Vedanta has grown inorganically through acquisitions of Hindustan Zinc, then Balco, and then subsequently Cane India. Now, Vedanta is very strongly positioned in the country in whatever revenue streams that it is in, that is iron ore, oil, oil and gas, zinc, copper, especially in zinc, where it's a world leader also. Since Vedanta gets almost 60% of its revenue from India, it's important that we analyze the macroeconomic outlook of the country. So the Make in India initiative, the Bharatmala initiative, the Smart City initiative will all lead to greater infrastructure spending that augurs well for the company, because these all initiatives will lead to higher demand for the commodities, and that is good for the company. Other than that, also FDI liberalization is there by the government in the industry. Also, however, there's political instability and political uncertainty, because of which there's certain political risk. Now, we have divided the risk into four categories, out of which we will be focusing more on the industry risk, because we feel that Vedanta is in a cyclical business and thus it has more importance. So the industry outlook. So considering, in case of zinc, the industry outlook is positive because the automobile industry is growing in the country. In the case of aluminium, there's a huge order book from Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. In the case of copper also, there's a huge demand for electrical machines. And electrical vehicles uses more copper in comparison to normal vehicles. That augurs well for the company. Also, energy demand of India is rising. However, in case of China, the demand for steel has been flat. And also, Vedanta has been benefited because there have been winter cuts of production in China. And the other thing is, because of the marginal cost of production for some smelters in China has gone up, that has rendered them uncompetitive. Other than that, in the last year, global commodities had a good year. In case of regulatory risk, we would just like to mention that in case of oil, there is considerable political risk because of OPEC and the Middle East. And also in case of power, where there's a huge rising interest in renewable energy.
When we discuss about Vedanta with the kind of structure they have, they're into so many natural resources business, we need to see two types of business risk. One at the company level, second at the segment level. When we talk about the company level risk, there are four critical risks we would want to discuss here. First one being access to capital. Because of the nature of the industry they are into, they might not be able to source fund at the competitive rates, or they might fail to meet their obligations as well. Second would be discovery risk. Discovery risk can again be segmented into two parts. That is exploring new reserves versus enhancing the output on the current reserves. Now, there's a discovery risk in case of exploring new reserves, that if new reserves are not found, basically the future visibility of the company is getting narrower. And as far as we are concerned about current reserves, if it is not meeting the forecasted levels of output, basically they can enter into significant losses as forecast revenues are not visibly happening. And in case of in case of discovery risk for existing reserves, if they are not able to enhance the current levels of the current, of the, if they are not able to enhance the current reserves, which can also defuel their growth. Currency exchange fluctuations will be taking in the financial risk. Regarding environmental protectionism, so since the whole world is growing very concerned about environment, what will happen with these companies is they have to invest a lot in their technological equipments, which will necessitate them to maintain the environment standards, as well as a lot of technology would go into it, which will directly affect their profitability by way of depreciation over the new assets. When we talk about the segmented risk, the non-ferrous metals, one thing that has been observed is there are a lot of challenges in operationalizing their investments in aluminium versus they're India's largest zinc miner and copper producer with 72% and 36% of market shares respectively. With regards to oil and gas, the only silver lining we find is the low per barrel cost of production, which leads them to operational efficiencies in their own segment. Versus when we talk about ferrous metals, in the Goa mine, the capacity has been banned, which entails that the miner might lose 1,000 crores of revenue. In case of power, the power generation industry is extremely competitive with Adani Power and Tata Power having stronghold. And with this, the independent power producers' rates are also becoming unviable. It is also to note that in the power business, 60% of the power is used for captive purpose versus 40% is only given to commercial production. The political, legal, taxation and regulatory risk are more so similar for everybody, except there is one specificity for each of the segments. For example, let's talk about oil and gas. They stand, they have a 30 crore demand from taxmen, which does not seem as of now that it will be waived, meaning thereby they have a contingent liability of 30,000 crores as of now. There's a possibility of non-extension of their current block of gas into Rajasthan in 2020. So what is happening is they are out of the three blocks, they have one block, there is a non-extension. There could be a non-extension as well as they would also have a risk of liability of 30,000 crores. Moving on to financial risk, the profitability quotient here, we need to analyze that out of the 5 years, operating margin has seen 2 rates and net margin has seen 3 rates. Let us compare 2017 with industry median. 2017, the operating margin was around 20% with net margin being 15% because in the previous year, the commodity prices were favorable to the businesses in this segment. Versus the industry median was 11.6 and 4.1. Now let's compare industry median with the average of the last 5 years, wherein we can see that Vedanta has performed miserably. When we talk about leverage, I would want to connect leverage with liquidity over here. Reason being, the current ratio in 2016 was 1.34, which was steady from 2014, which has decreased to 0.93 because there is a significant rise in short-term borrowings. So the short-term borrowings in 2016 were $3.7 billion, which raised to $7.6 billion, versus the long-term borrowings. Versus the long-term borrowings were also reduced only by $1.5 billion from 12 to $12 billion to $10.5 billion. Now there is an interesting thing when we talk about this current ratio being so drastically dropped. So what they have done is their zinc business, there was a payment of special dividend from their zinc business, which was taken through short-term borrowings. So basically what is happening is, I'm borrowing funds not for my operational purpose, however the repayment of which will be going from my operational income. So this is a kind of double burden on the business. The foreign exchange risk, when we talk about, so the intensity of the foreign exchange risk can be understood only when we know that what amount of the foreign exchange risk takes part of the total cash flow. So around 6% of the total cash flow revolves around foreign exchange risk or foreign exchange rate, effect of foreign exchange rate fluctuations. And 42% of the overall business is through foreign operations. Along with that, their group borrowings are also foreign foreign currency denominated, which gives them a lot of exposure.
Now we move on to the Altman Z-score. So this is a weighted average of all the factors that we take up. So this takes into account factors such as profitability ratios, leverage ratios, and thus what we find is, as per our analysis, the value of the Altman Z-score for Vedanta turns out to be 1.19, and it is very clear to the 1.1 value, which denotes a probability of default, which is very severe. Thus we conclude that the organization has significant financial risk.
Due to paucity of time, we would directly move on to our rating. So the current rating what Vedanta had was AA with a stable outlook. So there are two points we would want to talk about. One is the potential and expansion of earnings versus their a permanent reduction in their gross debt. So when we talk about expansion in earnings, they've never reported any EBITDA over 15%. And in this kind of industry where you are into natural resources, there is high risk, there are high returns as well. And whenever you're in an emerging economy, you will have a benefit of a greater amount of returns when you are compared with international peers. So, and we also saw the last 5 years net operating margin, net margin and operating margin, which was not very rosy. So that is one of the reasons that even though they're trying to expand, they are failing on that front as of now. And a permanent reduction in gross debt, also entails that they had a recent raise of funds at 6.125% they'd raised. So, which was oversubscribed 2.6 times. Now, what we believe is when they're trying to elongate their maturity, that they're lengthening the age of their maturity, an investor would not want to invest in a lower coupon rate bond. However, this particular issue received 2.6% of oversubscription, which we believe that is a one-off event. And we believe that AA is a too optimistic outlook, and with a stable it is too optimistic. We would want to downgrade by two notches to A plus with a stable outlook. Thank you.
So in your rating downgrade, have you also taken into consideration the Vedanta PLC debt? If yes, then obviously it's fine. And if it's no, what are the reasons? And if yes, what is the total debt on Vedanta PLC? And is it relevant for determining Vedanta domestic rating?
So on the whole, answering directly to your first question, we have not considered a great amount of effect of Vedanta Resources PLC. But on the other hand, we have considered small nuances that when the special dividend was paid from Hindustan Zinc to Vedanta, it was eventually going to flow down to Vedanta Resource PLC. So there are certain aspects of which have been considered because of the... So when we are rating Vedanta Resources on certain aspects of their own business structure, that would directly affect Vedanta Resources PLC. But a specific effort to directly cover Vedanta Resources PLC was not made explicitly.
So new capacity is ramping up production, cutting costs, reducing debt, and you'll downgrade by two grades, I mean by the two notches. It's not very clear what's really leading.
So we agree that they have been trying to reduce their cost but ramp up shipments, but they have not been able to capitalize on their cost reduction initiatives. And as well as when we see the last year, the results of last year. So there was when we talk about again, so the last year commodity prices helped them a lot. So that was one reason for this profitability. And when we talk about leverage, they've been trying to reduce their debt, but it is not as rosy as it seems because as we mentioned, that they're trying to reduce their long-term debt by their corporate restructuring, but they've also taken it short-term debt. That is, they've taken around $4 billion of short-term debt and reduced $1.5 billion of long-term debt.
And so also on the qualitative front, we believe that the KA in India tax issue is a big problem because also its 2020 license for again Canada production is also there as a risk. And the other thing is that in China, there were winter cuts of production. Plus, a lot of production in China went out of production. But however, we feel that is temporary, and that is why there might be a negative effect of that. So we took both the qualitative and the quantitative as well.
So I have one question with the US tariffs being increased on aluminum imports from China, and China closing down some of the smelters because of the environment. Make in India and the opening of the mining sector in this country, do you still think that they will not be able to increase their margins?
So there are two things we would want to propose here. So yes, we agree that Make in India campaign is pushed along and FDI is also taken into picture. But we are into a business where there is business only when there is a discovery of reserves. That is very important. Like unlike other business, if you open up FDI, there will be inflow of funds. There are many businesses, if let's say a normal manufacturing business or a trade business or a service industry, where there is a direct business available. Here you have to discover your business and then only the opening up of FDI or receiving funds would eventually help.
Also on the other front, aluminum prices had risen a lot because of President Trump's election also afterwards, that there would be a lot of spending. But however, that spending has actually not come in still. So that is also a factor that we had considered.
Sorry, I hope this is the last question. My question is, if we look at it from the data that you're providing, the full cycle of the company seems to be improving, be it working capital, leverage, liquidity position, cash flow, free cash flows and all. At the same time, the model that we used, the Altman model is, to my mind, I think maybe not the right model, because the traditional model gives you a better sync for these type of companies versus the mid-corporate. So my question is, I know you've given a contrarian view, I'm still challenging why we need to look at a downside model risk, because I'm not seeing that coming out in the presentation.
Sir, taking the first point towards working capital. So, sir, essentially, their working capital in this year has not been improving. Rather, it has been going bad because it's turned negative. The current ratio is 0.93. So, their total current assets were around $12.4 billion versus their current liabilities were $14 billion. So, effectively, the net working capital has gone negative. On the second front,
which is good, actually, because they are cash flow positive.
So, agreed they're cash flow positive, but now the way they're financing this is, again, when we talk about reduction of debt, as you mentioned, this doesn't seem a very rosy position when we talk about facts. As along with numbers, yes, they've improved from 10.3 to 4.76, their total debt to EBIT ratio. However, they've done this, so the funds which were required in the business, they've done it via short-term borrowings, by borrowing $4 billion excessively and only reaping $1.5 billion a year. So this, in isolation, seems very good, but when we try to cover the facts about short-term borrowings as well, we believe that it essentially is not improving, rather than it is creating its own problem, because the business they are into would not require so much of short-term borrowings, and the payment of which will be only done in the long term. Yes, sir. Regarding the Altman Z-score, so we agree that Altman Z-score was not originally developed for India. It was developed for companies in US, but this is an emerging market model. A small modification was made so as to serve as a proxy for emerging economies or developing economies. Basically, the fifth asset turnover ratio was removed out of the consideration, and the remaining four factors, it's a accumulation of the remaining four factors about profitability, coverage, leverage, and market value of equity. So because of that, and this is just a proxy, it is just one of the indications, it cannot predict exactly, but then it serves as a guidance.